about the life on Mars and a lot of the other things going on that want to know about, but there's others that don't want you to know about. Anyway, we're going to go ahead and get started. I believe Andy, you're going to go first.
Thank you, James. Our presentation today is entitled Discovery of Life on Mars. And we're going to cover some of the material that I covered in my paper in 2008 entitled Discovery of Life on Mars. And then Alfred is going to be discussing some corroborating evidence in another NASA photograph that we discovered since last year. Then I'll come back and discuss some of the implications of the discovery of life on Mars. And then Alfred will review the agenda of the organization we found at the Mars Anomaly Research Society, which is going to be pressing for full disclosure about the fact that Mars is an inhabited planet, and that there are implications and complications to that that we better start evaluating as a planetary civilization here on Earth. So in our first section, we have the discovery. Mars is an inhabited planet. Evidence that Mars harbors several types of human beings, numerous animal species, and elaborately carved statues is contained in PIA 10214, PIA 11049, and other NASA photographs that Mars is presently evaluating, and that we've found humanoid life in as well. The discovery of life on Mars was made, that is, present life on Mars was made by myself. I'm Andy Basiago. I'm a lawyer here in Washington State. And I summarized my findings in my paper, The Discovery of Life on Mars, in 2008. I was one of America's early time space explorers. From 1969 to 1972, I served in a classified research and development project under the aegis of DARPA. It was called Project Pegasus. This was the U.S. government's classified program in applied quantum physics. In that capacity, I took part in revolutionary experiments in teleportation-based time travel, which was operational by 1970. There were two emphases, essentially a Tesla-based teleportation technology and devices called chronovisors, which were electro-optical devices developed by two Vatican scientists, Arnetti and Gemelli, which allowed for real-time moving holograms of past and future events. So I was one of the children brought into the project by my father, who was a Defense Department engineer. As a result of the childhood experience that I had of jump teleport at the old Curtis Wright Aeronautical Company facility in Woodridge, New Jersey, and popping out in the state capitol grounds in Santa Fe, New Mexico, in the early 80s, I was tapped to be one of the individuals who would teleport to Mars, which I did from a CIA facility located in El Segundo, California. Yes? Teleport means to travel through a vortal tunnel in time-space that's opened up artificially and to pass through it. Essentially the opposite of the form of teleportation described in Star Trek. We were physically going through an interstitial chasm in time-space. Yes, and my research over the last 10 years has, I've collected multiple data points establishing that I was in New Mexico as a result of teleporting there. So that's another story. Now there are data points between my childhood experiences and the Mars discovery in the sense that because by 1970 the U.S. government was sending personnel forward in time and recovering artifacts, one of the things that happened to me when I was on Project Pegasus as a child is I was permitted to read my 2008 paper, The Discovery of Life on Mars. So that's why I referenced this here. They were bringing things like books back, and because they thought this was a significant paper, they had me read it as a child and try to remember as much of it as I could. But of course, it was a work of original authorship then in 2008. My discovery of life on Mars is now the target of a disinformation campaign defaming me and also distorting the evidence that I've published that Mars is inhabited. This is being done both by past and present employees of NASA working in the mass media and even figures within exopolitics. One thing that we want to make clear as we start off is that the Mars cover-up by NASA is linked to the quantum cover-up by DARPA and other U.S. agencies. The U.S. fears that were to affirm that life exists on Mars, the public might learn that the U.S. has been sending individuals to Mars via teleportation for over 25 years and has placed secret bases there. I'm speaking out now because I believe that as the natural heritage of humankind, human beings on Earth have a right to the truth about the natural history of the solar system that we inhabit. The discovery of life on Mars is a major work in natural history that achieves over 50 firsts in science. It's the first work to prove that life exists on another planet, the first to analyze life forms and ancient artifacts found in one place on another planet, the first to find and name human and animal species on another planet, and the first to ever publish a photograph of an intelligent humanoid being living elsewhere in the cosmos, which we see here, which is a being standing inside an area we're calling the rock enclosure on Sokovsky Ridge, west of the home plate plateau within the Columbia Basin of Mars. The discovery of life on Mars also contains highly significant data that's available because of the great accomplishments of our space agency. It's the first data from Mars to contain images of humans and animals. We haven't seen that before in the analysis of photographs taken from the satellites. The beings in the data are captured in their natural living state, which we've never seen before. The data is derived, as I said, from NASA photographs taken on the surface of Mars rather than from aerial satellites. And the data is in living color and reveals not just the red, but also the ochre, coral, pewter, turquoise, and other colors of the real Mars. That's why after writing my paper, The Discovery of Life on Mars, I wrote to the president of the National Geographic Society on behalf of our organization, Mars, asking that my findings be published in National Geographic as a major discovery in natural history. For geography does not end at the Earth's geostationary orbit, and as National Geographic stated recently, in fact a month before my paper was published, space is the once and future frontier of the human race. The discovery of life on Mars analyzed a single mass of photograph that we see here. This is the one captioned PIA 10214. It's a westward panorama of the West Valley of the Columbia Basin in the Gusev crater of Mars, taken by NASA's Mars exploration rover Spirit in 2007 and beamed back to Earth in January of 2008. As I wrote in my paper, this image is the most significant photograph ever taken by human beings from Earth because in it, humanity has crossed the threshold that separates our past as an Earthbound race from our future as a spacefaring civilization in contact with extraterrestrial species. The discovery of what PIA 10214 contains had its roots in the public scrutiny that this anomaly here attracted beginning in January 2008. It's the apparent form of a human female jutting up from the far left edge of the home plate plateau. Like many people around the world, I wondered, was this a natural rock formation, which is what his skeptical opinion was. Was it a statue of a human figure, a female figure? Was it the fossil of a humanoid who had once lived there? Or was it a being, a living being, traversing rightward across the edge of the cliff? I concluded in early 2008 that it's a statue. We can say that because first of all, it's accompanied by a male figure who is lying over on the right of the female form. Together, these two figures possess nine traits of stature. First of all, the female figure is on a pedestal, and rock statues need pedestals to stand upright. Both possess highly articulated human form that we have not seen in any natural rock formation on Earth that seems to appear human. There's duality in the sense that there are two forms there. There's also correspondence in the sense that the right edge of the male figure corresponds orthographically with the left edge of the lower extremities of the female figure in the way that statues are conjoined artificially. These two statues possess gender. There's a female figure and a male figure adjacent to her. Both are clothed, which is another characteristic of statuary. They both have been carved, well, she's been carved to exhibit movement. We see artistic styling. And also they fragment. We know that that's something that stone statues frequently do. And Venus de Milo, for example, once had arms. But that's not really the significance of this anomaly, which was so widely published in 2008, really ever since. Because the photograph has always appeared on the internet too closely cropped. It's been photographed just to focus on the female figure at the top. But in fact, I made a shocking discovery by stepping back and looking at more of the photograph. I found that the beings on the edge, as I'm calling the two figures, because they're on the edge of the plateau, are sitting atop a large rock carving of a reptile biting the neck of a human being. You can see that in the picture on top. There is the profile of a snake or reptile, and he's reaching over and biting the neck of a bearded male human, and there's blood issuing across the chest of the human figure that forms the larger pedestal for this figure, which has been so widely publicized. Then I found something even more disconcerting. I found that beyond the statue, in the arroyo to the west of the home plate plateau, lies a field of humanoid bodies. We haven't counted them, but there are at least hundreds of humanoid forms that are laying on the ground, and they seem to be, in fact, corpses. In different parts of that killing field, that debris field of human bodies, serpents can be seen both slithering across the bodies and poking their heads up from within this Martian killing field or cemetery grounds or whatever, in fact, it ends up ultimately being. I think that the statue on the of the beings on the edge may be some form of an altar of human sacrifice, perhaps. Perhaps it's a statue at an open-air cemetery. It may be a statue that glorifies the killing of humanoids by reptoid creatures, or it may be just a very bizarre piece of Martian public art, because as I branched out and examined more of the photograph, I could say that the Martian artistic sensibility is very bizarre, so we have to keep that in mind when we analyze this very macabre statue at top. The beings on the edge are a statue essentially above a Martian cemetery or killing field, or area where there's fossilized human remains, perhaps. I doubt that, because it looks fresher than that. And that's a major finding on Mars that the space agency has been concealing from humanity because of the consequences of revealing it. Essentially, the little lady that's been focused on so much on the internet and the press is sitting on the top of the statue. She's then standing on a pedestal, and that pedestal is mounted on a much larger rock carving, which shows in profile the head of a reptile or a serpent lunging forward and biting the neck of a human figure that can be seen staring forward. I will just briefly outline his shoulders and head. So there's a three-dimensional form, and then there's a more two-dimensional rock carving that they're mounted on. NASA is manipulating its images from Mars to conceal disturbing data of this kind. First, it's manipulating scale so that vast vistas of Mars are condensed within very small photographic parameters. It's also altering colors so that the blue, green, and other colors of Mars are lost behind a red sameness. For example, in this artifact, the head of the serpent was painted with different colors, red, green, and those are lost when you look at the NASA photograph as posted on their archive pages. It's also been altering, brightness and contrast downward so that the details are difficult to perceive. In this way, NASA is essentially serving two masters. It's fulfilling the NASA Act of 1958 by promoting the expansion of human knowledge of space, which was its first mission under the NASA Enabling Act of 58. But it's also complying with the decree of the CIA's Robertson Panel of 1953 to suppress all evidence of extraterrestrial life. Having been on Mars, and in fact, as we were leaving on the second trip, I was with a CIA agent by the name of Courtney M. Hunt. There was a creature over on our right, and I said, "Tell me that that's not a predator, Courtney." And in fact, he said, "Well, sorry, friend, it is." And we were about 40 feet from the apertures to the Martian underground, under these large skull-like structures that dot the landscape of Mars. And he said, when we get about 20 feet from the portal there, from the head, just start running like hell. And we left him to this skull-like statue, like, let's say, baseball players would dive into their dugout, as this thing sort of hit the aperture there, and fortunately we were able to flee and get back into the Martian underground where their civilization is. So having been chased by one of these plesiosaurs or plesiosaur-like creatures, a creature that did not survive the KT extinction on Earth, and also having been aware of the fact that on Mars, statues of heads and skulls and masks are used to conceal openings to the Martian underground, I wondered what had happened on the surface of Mars since I was up there several times in 1981. So therefore, throughout 2008, I examined NASA image PIA 10214, finding what I wrote at the time, that it holds a cosmic treasure trove of pictographic evidence of life on Mars, including humanoid beings, animal species, carved statues, and built structures. Here we see one of the statues of the head. These are, in fact, large objects, and the eyes provide access to concrete bunkers, so to speak, that are access to the Martian underground. Thus far, we've identified five typologies of humanoids in NASA photograph PIA 10214 that I identify in my paper. The first typology are humanoid beings with large bulbous heads and spindly bodies, not unlike the gray ETs that have been cited in the literature of alien-human contact for decades, but whose ultimate origin remains disputed in ufology and largely ignored within exopolitics. This kind of humanoid can be seen standing in the rock enclosure on Sokolsky Ridge. This is the first humanoid being ever discovered on another planet to be published on this planet. Here we see a humanoid standing in the rock enclosure. Those aren't four rocks, there are three, and the body of the humanoid is breaking up a large rock at the back. This is identifiable on the internet, in NASA's photographs. Yes? Well, essentially you can't see the data when you look at the NASA photograph. So I imported them into a program and took out very small sections and then enlarged them. And that results in blurriness, but it also defeats the NASA cover-up regarding what's actually in the photographs. Here's another area in the photograph. It's over on the far right of 10214, where this first typology of humanoid can be seen sitting around what we're calling the rock garden near this grotesque human skull. Let me point to the beam.
One here.
There's actually five or six sitting around as if they're recreating in front of this grotesque humanoid skull. Here's an enlargement of two of the humanoid beings on the left side of the grotesque humanoid skull. The apparently female figure has multiple appendages, as we can see on the upper right of the picture. The second typology are transparent forms like glass totem poles. Some Mars Notley researchers think this is a photographic effect when animals move while spirit is taking their picture. Over on the right, we see an enlargement in black and white of one of these glassy forms with multiple appendages that we found in various places in the photograph. The third typology of humanoid beings on Mars combines the head and upper body of modern human beings on Earth with the lower body of an arachnid of the order of scorpionine, in other words, a scorpion. A colorful example of one of these scorpion men can be seen in the turquoise field in the upper right quadrant of 10214. He has a horn on his head, is situated in front of smaller creatures that may be his progeny, and he's looking up towards the rover Spirit. His bright turquoise body matches the color of the bright turquoise rocks that dot the Martian landscape. So here we see a blurry enlargement of the scorpion man and a more condensed enlargement over in the right corner of the photograph. The fourth typology are the forms that are almost all head, like the comedic form that we've christened Mr. Potato Head, which might not be a life form at all, but rather a big cartoonish building or statue. as verified in other NASA photographs that we've analyzed. The Martians have a penchant for including statues of large comedic figures like this in some of their village areas. So they tend to decorate neighborhoods with large comedic statues that resemble, let's say, floats in Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. The fifth typology are the humans that can be seen in different places in the photograph. They are bald, wear black or blue caftans or gray jackets, and resemble old men on Earth. They are probably our long-lost relatives, separated from us by the solar system catastrophe in 9500 BC that devastated Mars and then eclipsed the great maritime civilization on Earth that built the Great Pyramid and the Sphinx. In addition to humanoid beings, there are many different types of animal species on Mars, numerous animals. 10214 contains photographic evidence of four categories of animal species on Mars, seen as either living species, or excuse me, living creatures, or as statues. The first category includes animal species that exist on Earth at this time, or that closely resemble animals that presently exist on Earth. In this category, we would place elephants, a platypus or hippopotamus type figure, horses, cows, frogs, tortoises, serpents, and snails, although I have to add the caveat that the snail on the far right has the head of what we would consider a human being. It's a snail with a hominid's head in front of the photograph. The second category of animal species on Mars combines the elements of animal species that inhabit Earth at this time. I'm a trial lawyer by profession, so my voice is gone at this point. I've been in trial for a couple of weeks. The second category of animal species on Mars combines the elements of animal species that inhabit Earth at this time in its biological history, and that from our perspective are hybrids of living animal species on Earth, to include this animal that combines the traits of a dog, has a dog-like face or a lion-like face, and a furry body that nonetheless has the form of an octopus, but is terrestrial rather than aquatic in nature. The third category includes reptile species extinct on Earth. In this category, we can place the plesiosaur, which is often proposed as a solution to the Loch Ness, Lake Champlain, and Lake Okanagan mysteries. A reptile with a bulky body like a tortoise and a long neck like a snake, plesiosaurus is quite common on Mars, but did not survive the KT extinction on Earth. They're so commonplace that we've actually taken this image on the left of this plesiosaur as the logo of our organization. The fourth category includes animals that have never existed on Earth. This category encompasses several animals that are unlike anything that has ever lived on Earth to our knowledge. In this category, we can place the human-lizard hybrids seen on the ground as if cold-blooded and immobile by nature near the rock garden. So there are also many of these very flat lizards crawling around the surface of Mars. In this category of animals never seen before on Earth, we can also place the species that I call the woofie. I'm trying to give these creatures names that school children can identify and kind of destigmatize the whole fact that the red planet is inhabited. The woofie could be mistaken for a sagebrush or tumbleweed on Earth were it not for its puppy dog face. So it's essentially a big fluffy creature. When you step back from the image, you can see a figure that we would think would be the dog of a very cute puppy on Earth. These and other animals on Mars defy classification by any known system on Earth. We would include among them a curious animal whose giraffe-like head can be seen peering from behind the cliff, literally within feet of the rover Spirit. This animal has red lips, a patch of blue beneath bulging eyes, and a crest atop its head like some dinosaurs possess. I'm calling this the spying giraffe because it's giraffe-like and it's looking up from behind a rock at the rover Spirit. And of course, the colors we're finding these animals correspond with the beautiful colors of Mars, the reds, the blues, and we might conclude could in fact be camouflaged. We can draw two conclusions about the variety of animal species on Mars as shown by the small sample of animal life on Mars in photograph 10214. First, reptile species abound on the red planet. Here we see a living plesiosaur on the left and a dead plesiosaur on the right. We've also concluded that reptoids are engaged in widespread predation of humanoids on Mars. Here we see very disturbing images of reptoids consuming humanoid prey. Mars is what Earth might be like if the smaller dinosaurs had survived. So here we see a turtle-like reptile chomping on a humanoid, and there's the lower extremities of a humanoid laying over on the right. On the photograph on the right, a humanoid is laying on his right side. His legs, the bottom part of his legs have been bitten off, and there's a reptile or turtle-like head of a larger creature standing behind him as if guarding his quarry. Reptoid creation may be the cause of the human bodies that litter the valley bottom, where they are sort of fructifying in a sticky morass, as if decaying corpses. These corpses can also be seen on the home plate plateau itself, deposited in great slag heaps, as this center photo shows. At right, a serpent can be seen slithering across the bodies as a humanoid being tries to extricate himself by walking out of the morass of bodies. Now, when we look at the fact that this photograph shows archaeological evidence of an altar, a possible altar of reptilian sacrifice of humanoids, forensic evidence of hundreds, possibly thousands of humanoid bodies, and biological evidence contained in the last photo that reptoid predation of humans is commonplace on Mars, we have to ask whether the reptilian agenda identified by researchers like David Icke may be germane to the whole solar system. If that's the case, I believe that my findings may be of interplanetary security significance. Let's take a look at some of the carved statues on Mars. So far, I found numerous carved statues in PIA 10214. Just on Sulkovsky Ridge, one of the prominent landforms there, I found 12 statues of humanoid and animal heads. In fact, there are so many stone monuments featuring faces in this westward view of the West Valley of the Columbia Basin that we can safely now conclude that the face on Mars at Cydonia is a stone monument. It creates a rebuttable presumption, as we would say in the law, that the face on Mars at Cydonia is a stone monument. Simply put, shaping natural rock formations into human heads, faces, and masks is a characteristically Martian art form. Here we see 8 of the 12 heads, carved statues, if you will, of human and animal heads that I found just in the 100 feet of Sulkovsky Ridge on the left center of photograph 10214. Some of them have multiple faces in the nature of a Picasso painting where he had one being with several faces to its physiognomy. One of the most surreal objects that I discovered in PIA 10214 is, as I mentioned, this grotesque humanoid skull in the rock garden over on the far right side of the photograph. This skull-shaped head features a broad humanoid cranium with a pointy crown, deep eye sockets, large elephantine ears, and bony hands that are protruding upward from beneath the Martian underworld. Objects like these are used to cover openings on the surface of Mars that connect to the civilization below, and that intelligent humanoids like ourselves and our fellow humanoids up on the surface of on planet Mars can identify as artificial structures and find these openings to the underground, but that animals cannot discern the meaning of. So here we see the grotesque humanoid skull with its pointy crown and large elephantine ears. Two of the most striking statues in 10214 are the face of a boy and the head of a dog, which are found along the jagged edge of the home plate plateau, again, very close to the rover Spirit. The face of the boy on the upper image here has been cast in a bronze medal that has oxidized and is adjacent to the mask of a medicine man carved from the native black, coral, and turquoise bedrock of the plateau itself. The head of the dog has been made to look very brutal, even menacing. Martian's stature reveals an artistic sensibility that might be described as weird. So that in the lower picture, we see the face of the dog, which resembles a more vicious breed of dog, perhaps like a Doberman Pinscher here on our planet. Next to the face of a boy, we can see a humanoid form struggling up the terraced steps of the cliff. We don't know whether this is part of the statuary complex or an actual being, but you can see him in the bottom half of the photograph, walking upstairs with all four appendages. This exquisite complex might be a shrine, a vista point, or a power spot where religious rituals, nature walks, or spiritual healings take place. One of the most striking works of art on Mars, this sacred location, which we're calling Shaman Point, may one day be regarded as one of the most impressive works of large stonework in a natural setting in the solar system, the Martian Mount Rushmore. Here's a color rendering of Shaman Point with the face of the boy on the right, the exquisite carving of the mask of a medicine man next to him, and then a figure walking up the steps toward this vista point. Here we see the face of the dog, which provides cover for this lion giraffe looking over the rock. And from this perspective, it's a little easier to see the sharp, the jagged facial physiognomy of this particular statue. The most intriguing statuary complex in this photograph is located down the escarpment of the plateau from the beings on the edge, where there are numerous carved statues. On the left, we see sort of a seal, simply of a human face, or a humanoid face. Elsewhere, right past the little lady, right down the escarpment, we find the profile of a lion, the head of a horse, a tropical fish, a bee that's lying backwards that has the gold head of a man atop it, and more of a cute animal face like a kit fox, perhaps a dog in him. Here's a blow-up of the bee with the gold head of a man on it. This is not a living creature, because we've identified the fact that the wings have been carved out of the cliff. We're wondering what the Martians were trying to tell us with a bee lying on its back that was discovered in such close synchrony with the bee diet that we've been experiencing on this planet. Now, proof that these are carved statues rather than random rocks is established by the fact that the tropical fish has clearly been moved a considerable distance up the plateau. And we can identify that fact because he couldn't have tumbled there, because there's no evidence he tumbled down the plateau. And there are drag marks behind the tropical fish coming up, in terms of altitude, up the face of the plateau. So presupposing that the laws of gravity and motion and so forth are in place on Mars as they are in our habit, on our planet rather, we can conclude that this indicates that this is a rock that was not only carved, but then pushed into its present location. The drag marks, of course, resembling, let's say, the marks that you leave in a carpet when you push a heavy piece of furniture. There are also a number of very fascinating built structures that we've identified in this photograph. One is the sarcophagus of the king that lies like a toy soldier on the right side of the cliff, again, very close to the spirit. He has a hat that is identical to the one worn by Nefertiti on the iconic bust of her found by the archaeologist Borchardt at Amarna, Egypt in 1912. These colors are several of Mars' elemental colors. I'm speaking of the dark turquoise blue of his vestments and hat, and then the blood red and drab green bandit, which we also find on Nefertiti's hat. We believe this establishes the connection between ancient Egypt and ancient Mars. The sarcophagus might be an ossuary containing the remains of an Egyptian pharaoh, early Mars explorer, or governor general of the Mars colony from the time before the solar system catastrophe of 9500 BC, when ancient Egypt and Mars were part of an interplanetary civilization. This form that we're calling the water sprite might be an aqueduct. There's an aqueduct. Water is scarce on Mars, but we know that it exists there. There is an azure blue lake immediately beneath Husband Hill on the right horizon in the photograph. On a desert planet, human survival would depend on sophisticated waterworks, perhaps disguised to resemble artworks like this to protect water supplies from interlopers. So we don't know. This may be a statue. It may be a sophisticated viaduct of some kind. We've also found this intriguing face of a bull that appears to have been forged from metal. Its discontinuous design is reminiscent of the drawings of M.C. Escher. This terrace structure might once have served as a dwelling or a viewing platform at a vista point that overlooks the valley that we see in this photograph. We can see that the object has multiple levels. Next to it is the head of a lizard. It may be the fossil of a large reptile or dinosaur, but we know that, like a sculpture, it's hollow because we can see several tiny Martians standing in its mouth on the front edge of the lower part of its jaw. And now I'd like to turn it over to my good friend and distinguished colleague, Alfred Lambermont Weber, to provide corroborating evidence of what we have thus far found in PIA 10214.
Thank you. This is PIA 10214. It's not the only NASA photograph in which Andy has found evidence of life on Mars. Corroborating evidence is contained in PIA 11049, a southward view of the West Valley of the Columbia Basin, taken from the home plate plateau during the first 6 months of 2008. This NASA image, which is on the internet, also contains evidence that life exists on Mars. Now, here you can see in PIA 10214, the tilling of the soil in a regular way there. And this is consistent with the purposeful cultivation of the land by advanced, intelligent humanoid beings, such as is found at mining, agricultural, and manufacturing sites on Earth. And waterworks appear to decant water to supply human activities at the site. And you can see this spout of water coming down there on the left. Sorry, on the right of the photograph. At the right side of the site is a built structure resembling the head of a bear. Water can be seen falling from a pipe into a cylindrical catch basin. And humanoid beings can be seen standing in front of the catch basin as if approaching a public bath or water well. And on the right is a close-up of the catch basin and of the water. At the time that Andy found and published his evidence of moving water and artificial waterworks on Mars, NASA was announcing that it had made, quote, the chilling discovery of ice on Mars. One way that NASA is perpetuating its cover-up of life is to conceal major discoveries while publicizing minor ones in this way, i.e. running water was discovered. NASA announces at the same time that, oh, ice exists on Mars. Near the falling water, a hodgepodge of different statues like those found at archaeological digs on Earth at places where statues were once made, such as an artist's studio or a foundry, litters the site. The statues are highly imaginative and arrayed in a chaotic way. The statues include the profile of a man in light blue, on the left, a screaming being in the middle, and a bulbous-headed being in pale green on the right. The man resembles a human on Earth, but the other two beings seem to possess the neoteny of the prototypical alien. The animals found in PIA 11049 include the Martian bear cat, which can be seen ambling along the ground with a human in its mouth. That's the left. The rock hopper in the middle, possibly a monkey. And the primate that Andy has named the Sendak on the right, in honor of author Marie Sendak, whose
where the wild things are presage some life forms on Mars. And here's a close-up the Martian bear cat south of the Obi-Home Plateau. And here is close-up and a closer photograph of the rock hopper hopping along a rock on Mars. See him there on the left. And here is a sendak on Mars. And you can see from the reproduction of the Maurice Sendak book cover where the wild things are with a sendak another than the animals.
Thank you. We're going to get two lawyers involved so we can get evidence to back that stand by our evidence. And hopefully people will believe us despite the fact that we're both attorneys. So what are the implications of these findings? First implication is that Mars is an inhabited planet. It is inhabited by humanoid beings like and unlike us, and by animals that are like those that exist on Earth at this time, that once existed on Earth in prehistoric times, or that are hybrids with the traits of two or more Earth species. These animal species include human insect hybrids and human lizard hybrids that do not exist on Earth and that, to our knowledge, have never existed on Earth, like the scorpion man that we see on the right bottom. The second implication is that the discovery of life on Mars is highly significant because it represents the first time that life has been found beyond the confines of Earth from the perspective of natural history, notwithstanding, of course, the government cover-up that human life is already up there, namely our own personnel. This is the moment of discovery dramatized in movies like Contact. Contact with other life forms in the cosmos has now begun. Contact brings with it the first evidence of humanoid life beyond Earth, and with it the implication that humanoid life might be common throughout an inhabited universe. Number three is Earth is not the only inhabited planet in our solar system, which comes as a shock to all of us just based on our upbringing, our schooling, our understanding of what reality concludes. This discovery will inspire a new Copernican revolution in such fields as anthropology, biology, archaeology, ancient civilizations, and exopolitics. The 21st century will be one of intergalactic contact for human civilization on Earth. We will discover other life forms on Mars and perhaps other planets, mindful that we are not just mere adventurers or explorers, but citizens of the cosmos. Implication four is that we cannot deny that the weight of the evidence shows that life on Mars resembles life on Earth. It shows evidence of such characteristics of life on Earth as speciation, predation, the division into male and female, the emergence of primates, such as the sendak, and symbiotic relationships between species. This indicates that life on Earth and Mars might have come from the same source, such as the custodians of the genetic heritage of our galaxy, and hence followed similar developmental pathways, but then diverged after our civilization and the Martian civilization were divided by that great catastrophe in 9500 BC. The fifth implication is that the anatomy of one type of Martian humanoid helps us solve the UFO mystery in the sense that it confirms that life exists beyond our planet, that such life includes intelligent bipedal hominids, and that a humanoid on Mars conforms to the quote-unquote aliens found in the literature of alien-human contact. We now know that human beings on Earth share a common template with other humans in an inhabited universe, and that therefore, like the visitors that have appeared in both the history and the fiction of alien-human contact, we are universal beings. Implication six is that Mars is the site of ancient artifacts of great archaeological significance, of utmost archaeological significance, that reveal the presence on Mars of an advanced intelligent civilization that has been there for a long time. The similarity of archaeological forms of Earth and Mars indicates an historical linkage between our two planets, specifically a critical connection between ancient Egypt and ancient Mars. Knowing the true history of this connection might optimize our chances of survival against the forces of solar system cataclysm in the future. Implication seven is that human activity, such as that by the United States and Russia, present and future, because it's our position that the United States is already up there, and publicly the space agencies of the United States and Russia are announcing their plans to place manned missions on Mars. These types of human activities should account for the diversity of humans, animals, and ancient artifacts on Mars, and carefully plan to protect these natural resources from the externalities of the mission. To do otherwise would violate the precautionary principle and the prime directive as they relate to the ecology and civilization of Mars, respectively. Simply put, Mars does not belong to us. It belongs to the Martians and all of its creatures, and we must respect that fact if we are to do the right thing as we continue our activities on the Red Planet. Implication 8 is that the evidence of life found in the Columbia Basin is so abundant, esoteric, and diverse that that fact alone deserves further scrutiny. The data provided by PIA 10-14 is so dense in establishing life on Mars that it could be called a veritable Disneyland of Martian ecology and culture. So why is that? We can't discount the possibility that the discovery of life on Mars in this context has involved a Martian or NASA educational scenario that is directed at us. We should explore further to determine whether and why this contact event might have been staged at this time in the Gusev crater of Mars, but we cannot exclude the possibility that this is in fact a planetary psyop of some kind. Implication 9 is that a reptilian power structure may be committing mass genocide against the mammalian humanoid population on Mars. At least that's where the weight of the evidence leads us. And that U.S. military operations may already be underway on Mars to protect the humanoid population there. If this is the case, then we will have to decide publicly whether to intervene on Mars in defense of established use cogens norms outlawing genocide against humans. And Mars defense policy will have to be openly debated because it implies a law and policy matter of tremendous gravity, that is, interplanetary warfare. And then the 10th and final implication is that looking at it, hopefully, the discovery of life on Mars is clearly one of the epochal events of the 21st century and begins a new chapter of the human adventure in outer space. Humanity has now crossed the threshold of first contact with other biological species in the cosmos. The question that I'm posing now, that now confronts us, is not, shall we permit the belief that Mars is inhabited? That was the previous question. The new question, the relevant question to be asking is, how shall we think about it now that we have knowledge to back up by evidence that another planet in our solar system harbors life? So now, having looked at the implications of this discovery, I'd like to turn over once again to Alfred Lambermont Weber to discuss the agenda of our organization, the Mars Anomaly Research Society.
So part 4 of this PowerPoint is the agenda. What do we do now? Well, Andy's findings are a vital issue in exopolitics, and I affirmed his findings and do affirm them. And I have published them at our website, which is www.exopolitics.com, and you can find the main paper there, a 41-page paper, The Discovery of Life on Mars, and approximately 30 other papers which you can download in PDF for free. And I've joined Mars as the chairman to craft a Mars agenda. And I recognize now that Mars is being visited and settled, and it must be protected from visitation, exploration, and colonization by human beings from this planet. So step one in what we do is public education. And we're going to be going around North America and the world educating the public that Mars is an inhabited planet with a fragile, beautiful, and diverse environment that is worthy of protection. That NASA photographs, PIA 10-14 and 11049, and other pictures on the internet contain images of Mars, several human species, and many animal species. that some of the beings on Mars are humanoid beings just like us that are probably related to humans on Earth. That the discovery of life on Mars will now bring an end to official state secrecy about extraterrestrial life. That NASA is concealing the existence of life on Mars and the U.S. presence there, even though its legislative mandate from 1958 forward was to promote, quote, the expansion of human knowledge of space. And finally, that the keepers of the consensus reality will try to have us believe that we don't see what the plain evidence of our eyes tells us we see, but that the truth that Mars is inhabited will prevail. Secondly, we are seeking, and we believe all of us should seek, presidential recognition. And we'll be lobbying the Obama administration to make the presidential statement that Mars is inhabited. To hold that the discovery of life on Mars requires the formulation of laws and policies governing humanity's interaction with Mars, and to adopt the precautionary principle to protect the ecology of Mars and the prime directive to protect the civilization of Mars. If we look, a presidential recognition of life on Mars would be a major accomplishment of the Obama administration. It would help heal the rift between Earth and Mars that followed the 9500 BC solar system catastrophe. In other words, 11,500 years ago, approximately, Mars and Earth were united at the social level. It would promote American leadership in the exploration of space by having a presidential recognition of life on Mars, as it was American technology through NASA that discovered life on Mars, and it would protect the future by extending international environmental law to ecosystems on other planets. Step three is disclosure, extraterrestrial disclosure of life on Mars. And we'll be lobbying the Obama administration to release secret U.S. government documents pertaining to the Mars cover-up, including the presence of U.S. personnel on Mars now. To disclose the U.S. government's knowledge about the past history and present conditions of Mars, and grant amnesty to federal whistleblowers who disclose classified information about Mars. And to reveal whether the U.S. government's agenda for Mars includes a plan to colonize it or to seize it for strategic military advantage. At the same time, our organization is going to file a lawsuit under the Freedom of Information Act, FOIA, to request disclosure of U.S. government secret Mars files. We're going to hold a press conference at the National Press Club announcing the discovery of life on Mars and the filing of the FOIA lawsuit. And we're going to urge whistleblowers to disclose what they know about the U.S. government's secret Mars agenda and place that on the Mars website. Public interest diplomacy, step four. We're going to be politically active at the international level and advocate for positive, peaceful public policies toward Mars at the UN General Assembly, which under UN General Assembly decision 33426 of 1978 invited UN members to coordinate research programs into extraterrestrial life. We're going to pursue formal acknowledgement of human and animal life on Mars and the Martian civilization by the UN General Assembly. And we're going to urge establishment of a UN Mars Protectorate to assess the impact of terrestrial probes on the Martian ecology and civilization. Finally, in terms of organization building, we're asking for your help to help us implement this interplanetary agenda. We're a nonprofit corporation chartered under the laws of the state of Washington. Our mission is to research, disclose, and educate the public about life on Mars and promote laws and public policies related to it. And lifetime memberships in Mars are available for one-time fee of $100 and five-year memberships for a fee of $50. All of these funds are going to go to fund the expenses such as the FOIA lawsuit against Mars. And this is just some of our contact information.
And now I'd like to offer some concluding remarks. It's my hope that we explore Mars in a spirit of brotherhood and fellowship, not just among ourselves, but with the Martians. We are all children of God, and we must now become citizens of the cosmos. I think some of you may be aware that I've taken a lot of criticism for declaring that Mars is inhabited. In fact, most recently, in a 3,000-word hit piece written by Ray Ballard, the news director for NASA's Hubble Space Telescope, who wasted the public's money to fake 3,000 words, distorting what I included in my paper and other writings, even disparaging my academic credentials. Now, why would NASA task the news director of the Hubble Space Telescope to do that if I wasn't working in a significant area, or in other words, if nothing had been discovered and I wasn't sharing valid data with the public? But that's criticism that I welcome. I don't want to lose sight of the fact that my critics are my brothers and fellow human beings. And this is a very disturbing discovery. And so Alfred and I have decided to essentially utilize a strategy of nonviolent resistance and not meet the criticism and the disparagement in kind. We're simply going to move forward in a positive direction and continue to research, disclose, and educate the public about the fact that Mars is inhabited until I'm sitting in the Rose Garden of the White House with my peer, born in summer 61, Barack Obama, to announce to the people of the world that Mars is inhabited and that we can say it's inhabited as a result of the accomplishments of our space scientists and technicians and the mere luck that a lawyer from Washington State had in finding that data. While we must look at Mars with the eyes of a child to see what magic it holds, we must also accept the fact that we're now leaving our childhood in an awe-inspiring and terrifying universe. For the first time, all the citizens of planet Earth may now behold life on another planet. I view that as a cosmic privilege, both a cosmic privilege to personally have been involved in the discovery of life on Mars, and also a cosmic privilege that everybody in this generation possesses, because we were alive on planet Earth when life was first discovered on another planet. So I'm urging us to explore the universe in a spirit of human solidarity with respect for each other and those we encounter as we journey onward and upward to the stars. Thank you.
This PowerPoint took up 60 minutes of the total 90 minutes, so we still have 30 minutes left. For those of you who would like to ask questions, there's a microphone there.
Yeah, I would like to, well, first of all, I would like to very much congratulate both of you for an exceedingly positive, open-hearted, humanitarian type of project. So that's is really wonderful, and to have people come here and speak that way. Now, as a scientist, I want to ask you something about how you see the realism of your mission.